I really appreciate the invitation. I'm trying to remember the last time I saw you and saw folks from the program was actually in New York when you did a trip to the Jewish Museum. And I was invited, well, I did a deli tour actually, I think, for some folks. We went around to some different delis and then we met at the Jewish Museum. And it was a lot of fun. I will always remember that as a highlight. So, but I've also been out to California and also spoken actually in Orange County at some of the synagogues that are at the JCC and some of the synagogues that are here tonight. So this is a kind of a new topic for me that came about as a result of the job that I had at AIPAC. And so while I was at AIPAC, I actually learned a lot about the U.S.-Israel relationship and about the importance of Israel to American Jews and non-Jews. And you know, I learned a lot of sort of talking points that I had to present when I was speaking at different synagogues and to different rabbis and things. And I realized that, you know, as important as foreign policy is and diplomacy and foreign aid and so forth, in terms of our relationship to the state of Israel, there's a whole other dimension to it that has to do with perceptions of the Jewish state that are filtered through popular culture, through the films and the television shows and the plays and, you know, music and all that good stuff, which is what I really specialize in, is really what my PhD is in theater. And I, you know, that's what really gets me excited is, you know, pop culture stuff and the history of popular culture. And so that's how I developed this talk. And what I want to suggest actually is that a fruitful way of looking at the U.S.-Israel relationship is through the psychological concept of the narcissistic extension. So in case people haven't heard of the concept of the narcissistic extension, I mean, everyone knows what narcissism is. And Freud wrote very, you know, famously about narcissism. And narcissism is something that we think of as, you know, really repulsive and horrible. And, you know, really only, I think they say maybe 1% of the U.S. population has a diagnosable narcissistic personality disorder, which is on the DSM, whatever they're up to with the DSM. But that all of us actually have a, you know, we have some piece of narcissism within us. We have a healthy narcissism, which is connected to self-love and our ego and self-respect and survival, I guess you would say. And so what I want to suggest in this talk is that, and this is, by the way, this is something that is very much a part of Jewish culture. And if you think about it, do we have the ability to use the chat now or not? Because I wanted to ask a question. I wanted to be able to see how people would respond to it in the chat. So my question is, okay, thank you. So my question is, what is the greatest pleasure for a Jewish person to have? And I'll give you a hint. It's not in English. It's not in Hebrew. It's in Yiddish. What is the Yiddish expression that sums up the greatest pleasure that a Jewish person can have in life? Kvelling. Okay, you're on the right track. But specifically, what kind of kvelling is the question? Nachas, right? Shepping nachas from fundi kinder, right? Or the enichlach, right? From the children or your grandchildren, right? That is, our children are the best example that I can give of narcissistic extensions, right? I mean, we want our children to succeed in ways and to have opportunities that we never had for ourselves. And that's good, you know, that's like a good thing. So my question though, if we see the frame of the U.S.-Israel relationship, is that in some sense, at least from an American perspective, Israel was a narcissistic extension of the United States, right? And I want to trace that, you know, throughout the history of popular culture over the last 100 years or so. Then we can end up with the question of, is it still, or has Israel now matured to the extent that it's not a child anymore, you know, that it's a grown-up country. It's actually one of the most powerful countries in the world, as we know. And, but I want to say at least throughout the 20th century, Israel functioned in this particular way. All right, so let's jump right in. And I want to start actually with a reference to Louis Brandeis. Brandeis, as many of you probably know, really was not an observant Jew in his youth. You know, he was not even particularly connected to Israel. This happened later in life for him. But eventually he became extremely supportive of the sort of the building up of Palestine in the Yishuv, in the settlement. And so he developed this idea that to be good Americans, we must be better Jews. And to be better Jews, we must become Zionists. Now, why does that come from? It comes from his progressive, right? I mean, he was an important figure in the progressive movement in the early 20th century, right? And so he was very concerned with workers' conditions and with child labor and all that kind of stuff. And he saw Israel as a place that could really exemplify the best and most important and highest values of sort of liberal democracy. And so that was where his idea came from, right? That this was a way for us actually to become the most patriotic Americans that we could become, was to become better Jews. So it's very much the opposite, you would say, of like this whole charge against Jews for many years of sort of this idea of dual loyalties, right? He's saying like, bring it on, right? We're gonna become better Americans by becoming better Jews, but he says to become better Jews, we have to become Zionists. Okay, so let's keep that in mind as we go along. And, you know, obviously before the founding of the State of Israel in the period of the teens and the 20s and so on, you know, there was some tourism to Palestine. There wasn't a lot, you know, there wasn't really air travel and all that kind of thing yet. But there was quite a bit of fundraising that happened. And so I wanna show you a few posters from New York during this period of the 20s into the 1930s. And the kinds of images that were used in some of these graphic representations, these visual representations, to kind of show what was happening in Palestine and how American Jews in particular should be supporting what was happening with Jews coming into Palestine and, you know, working the land and sort of reaping the bounty and studying, if you look on the bottom, right? And, you know, really sort of making this into a place that would, you know, realize all kinds of a promise, not just sort of, you know, theoretically, but actually practically. And you have quite a bit of commerce, right? I mean, you have the exportation from Israel to the United States of wine and of olive oil and of oranges from Jaffa and so on and so forth, right? So Americans are benefiting from the sort of cornucopia that is the land of Israel, and also benefiting from this idea that Jews, after centuries and millennia of persecution, now were becoming strong. You know, they were building up their muscles. They were really kind of coming into their own in a different way. And we could certainly analyze this in terms of gender stereotypes, you know, in terms of masculinity, the, you know, the Jewish man who was finally kind of like becoming macho, right? This is actually my favorite one. So I want to pause on it for a moment, because there's something actually very, very unusual about this poster. And so I'm gonna just check the chat again. What do you think is unusual about this that really differentiates it, at least from the other two that we looked at? But I can tell you differentiates it actually from any other poster I've ever seen from this particular period, in terms of fundraising for Palestine. Any ideas? What's sort of strange about this? It's a little, there's something weird about it and striking. Any ideas? The way he's dressed. Okay, good. Yes. It's not just, I mean, the question is, who is he? Who is this person who is the central figure in this poster? Yes, he's wearing American clothes. He's an American. He is an upper class American who is now sort of being installed at the center of the enterprise, you know, of the building up of Eretz Yisrael. And he's holding up the sign, right, that says in Hebrew, you know, collecting the shekels, right, the 500,000 shekelim from American Jewry, right? And so there's something really interesting about this. And Jeffrey Chandler writes about this. He's a professor of Jewish studies at Rutgers. He's probably spoken, before, I would imagine, right, at some point in the Community Scholars Program. If you've never heard him speak, he's an amazing speaker. He wrote an article several years ago in which he referenced this image, and he came up with this idea of sort of the impresario culture, you know, that Israel almost became for American Jews a kind of production that we were putting on for ourselves in a way, or at least that's the way that we viewed it, right? That they were satisfying that desire for almost creating a kind of theatrical spectacle that we could patronize, that we could contribute to, that we could be a part of. So keep that in mind too, because that becomes interesting later on in terms of some of the theatrical representations of Israel. All right, So I want to move forward, though, very, very quickly, because we are going to run out of time fairly. I want to just cover a pretty broad, I want to make sure we get to Fauda and all that stuff. So I just want to say that, you know, things sort of hummed along until obviously, you know, the late 30s, early 1940s, when there was this huge need for, you know, for a place to for Jews to go who were fleeing from Nazi Germany. And someone who actually played a really big role in this was a screenwriter named Ben Hecht, who some of you may have heard of. There's a recent biography of him in the Yale Jewish Lives series, really wonderful biography, by the way. He was also somebody who came very late. He was from Chicago. He was a newspaper man originally. He wrote the Broadway play, The Front Page, but he's also very, very accomplished. He won an Academy Award for his first screenplay that he wrote in Hollywood. It was called, I think, The Underworld. And from then on, he became like the most sought after screenwriter. He worked on Gone with the Wind, whatever. He was friends with Herman Mankiewicz, who wrote Citizen Kane. If you haven't heard about Ben Hecht, you really should look him up. But anyway, he met with Peter Bergson, who was this important figure from Israel, who was supporting trying to build up the Irgun, which was the basically terrorist organization that was trying to oust the British from Mandate Palestine. And so he started working with Bergson and starting all these committees and placing these very, very controversial ads in the newspapers like this one. And then he actually, the way this story becomes part of popular culture in particular is he started staging these pageants at Madison Square Garden and on Broadway, starting with one called We Will Never Die in the early 1940s. And you know, it was all about sort of the fate of the Jews of Europe and how we had to save the Jews of Europe. Now this was a time, I have to say, like late 30s, 1940s, I mean, you know, we were just sort of starting to wake up, right? This was news that was just buried in the pages of the New York Times and the Washington Post. You know, it was really only until 1943 that we even really knew that millions of Jews had been murdered and were being murdered, right? Late 1930s and early 1940s, there are Hollywood films about, you know, the struggle against the Nazis and so on and so forth, even a comedy, British comedy, basically. you know, it was really Hecht and Bergson and the actors they worked with that really started to raise awareness of what was going on. And so starting with We Will Never Die, and also with other ads like this, which I mean, this is incredible, this Letter to the Terrorists of Palestine from the early 40s, which is probably hard for you to see it because it's so small. I tried to put the whole thing on here. The print is really small, but I'll just read you very, very quickly, you know, one paragraph from it. In the past 1500 years, every nation of Europe has taken a crack at the Jews. This time the British are at bat. You are the first answer that makes sense to the new world. He's talking to the Jews of America. He's saying every time you blow up, he's talking about the Irgun basically, but he's saying Jews of America need to support the terrorists in Palestine. every time you blow up a British arsenal or wreck a British jail or send a British railroad train sky high or rob a British bank or let go with your guns and bombs at the British betrayers and invaders of your homeland, the Jews of America make a little holiday in their hearts. I mean, it was so supposed to be controversial, right? It was supposed to be really galvanizing, but it really, really interesting, I think. And you know, when he did this another show, which is on Broadway, called A Flag Is Born, you can see in the program, right? You see behind the Israelis with the flag and the shovel and the gun and the whatever, you see the fifers and the drums from the American Revolution. And that's exactly what he was trying to say, right? He was trying to say that these terrorists in Palestine are exactly parallel to the founding fathers of our country, right? And that was the way in which he was able to really, you know, as I said, galvanize support for, you know, for what was going on. And this play ran all over the country. It ran on Broadway, it ran in Chicago, in Detroit, in Philadelphia, in Boston. It was going to run in Washington, D.C., but at the time, Washington, D.C. didn't allow African-American people to go to theater, to go to a white theater, which is interesting to me. I just came back this afternoon. I was with my family at a play in Washington, And it was an all black play. It was about, you know, black experience. And, you know, obviously it was a, you know, one of the things that was great about it was actually being in an audience, in a mixed audience, and seeing the difference between how some of the white and some of the African-American people responded to what was going on stage. So it was moved to my hometown of Baltimore. So sort of early civil rights, you know, because of the protests, so sort of early civil rights activism. All right, so Leonard Bernstein is conducting the Palestine Symphony Orchestra as like the bombs are falling and whatever. And finally, you know, 1948 and into the 50s, he's returning over and over again to Israel to conduct concerts. There's more tourism to Israel, the Zimliners that are now famous. I mean, we know them basically as shipping, but you know, used to be, they were like cruise ships and that kinds of things. So people were, there was a lot more tourism. And then I want to speak also briefly about probably the greatest war photographer who ever lived. His name was Robert Capa. Again, if you've never heard of him, I really recommend your looking up his work. He actually was the only photographer who was at the Omaha Beach on D-Day. He traveled the world taking incredible photos. He was Jewish. He was Hungarian American. And he took some iconic photos of refugees who were landing in Haifa and starting a new life in Israel. I can't get enough of some of these photographs of, you know, life on the kibbutz and so on and so forth. Unfortunately, I mean, he had sort of a very tragic story. His lover was run over by a tank in one of the countries that he was working in, and then he actually had an affair with Ingrid Bergman, believe it or not. And then he himself was on assignment in Indochina, and he stepped on a landmine and he was killed at the age of 40. So it was like this huge loss. Fortunately, his brother Cornell actually kind of picked up where he left off and lived a long time, and also took some amazing photos. But so look up Robert and Cornell Capa if you're at all interested, as I am, in the way that he captured people's expressions and so on is just incredible. And then on into the early 1950s, Kirk Douglas. This is the first American film that was actually made in Israel about a Holocaust survivor who comes to Israel and has all kinds of emotional problems and so on and so forth. Attacks a police officer, gets in trouble. You can kind of see that in this. I'm not going to play. I was going to play like a short clip from the trailer, but I'm going to skip that. Also, this is made in some ways. This might be my favorite photo from the whole presentation. This is from Good Housekeeping magazine from the 1950s, and this is obviously Golda Meir doing her own dishes. This is before she was prime minister. She was foreign minister, right, in the 1950s, but she didn't have a live-in, you know, like a cleaning person or whatever. And so she did her own dishes when she, and so again, like how would an American audience read this, right? You're flipping through the pages of Good Housekeeping magazine. And how do you understand Israel other than through a kind of American lens, right? And of course, Golda Meir started out in Milwaukee, right? I mean, she was born in America. She was an American housewife, I guess you would say. I mean, before she moved to Israel. And so this made sense. This was sort of legible for Americans who in the 1950s, right, were really kind of discovering Israel, not just through tourism, but through a huge amount of, you know, cultural exchange, also buying a lot of Israeli merchandise. I mean, I don't know if synagogue gift shops are quite what they used to be, but synagogue gift shops, you know, used to sell a ton of, like, if you remember, like the old, like the olive wood candlesticks, you know, and those like those ashtrays and, you know, all this stuff. I mean, just having something from Israel in your home, you know, was a big deal. There were exhibits, traveling exhibits of Israeli art, you know, and there were Israeli dancers. Israeli dance starts to be a big thing, right? Folk dance, for example, and the Inbal Dance Theater appearing on Dinah Shore's show. Dinah Shore was herself also born Jewish, right? And there starts a whole craze for, and what's interesting about this also, right, is this is the Ethiopian Jewish, you know, company. So it's very exotic. It's Israel already is exotic and now sort of like doubly exotic. In a way, you know, like what are all these like North African Jewish customs all about, and what does this mean? You know, the thing that's funny about it is that a lot of the gestures and a lot of the movements of the inbal were actually taken from Martha Graham. They weren't so exotic after all. But you know, there's been some interesting. There's an article about this not too long ago about sort of what this meant for American Jews to encounter, you know, and not just dance but also folk music, right? Was a big thing as well. Let me just play just a little bit of folk dance. I won't go into analyzing all the movement vocabulary and whatever kind of thing, but I will say that there were really pioneering dancers like Fred Burke, who comes to the United States and starts at the Jewish Theological Seminary, a whole department of Jewish dance, right? And then at the 92nd Street Y in New York, which becomes really, you know, I mean, there are whole books being written about, you know, the role of the 92nd Street Y in terms of really beginning a whole sort of, you know, movement practically in terms of Jewish dance in the United States. And very popular, not just among Jews, by the way, but among non-Jews as well. You know, lots of other religious, you know, churches and whatever become really enamored of Israeli dance. That's a whole subject. That's like a whole talk in and of itself. But I think really interesting because again, you know, I mean, in terms of like, we usually think of kind of, you know, when we think about cultural representations of Israel and we're watching movies and we're watching TV shows and things like that, or we're listening to music and it's very passive, but with dance, I mean, a lot of people were getting up and, you know, it was becoming part of like, you know, synagogue cultural life and Jewish summer camps and Jewish day schools and Hebrew schools and Hillels, right? I mean, really, really, there's a lot to be said about that. But I want to spend most of my time today talking about film and television and maybe a Broadway play or two. the reason why I included the Ten Commandments is because Ten Commandments is released in 1956. And what happened in 1956? We all know the Suez Canal crisis, in which Nasser nationalizes the Suez Canal in Egypt. And this sets off a whole, you know, sort of train of diplomatic, you know, crises and so on. And I mean, Israel and Britain and France all decide that they're going to attack Egypt and they're going to free up the shipping routes because so much of the world's oil is flowing through the Suez Canal. And Eisenhower actually says, forget it, it's not happening. And he forces them. I mean, he takes everything in his arsenal, basically at his disposal, and he forces them to back down. And it's kind of like a low point in terms of the U.S.-Israel relationship, you could say. And I remember at AIPAC, we studied this, you know, and it was like, okay, what were the high points and what were like the low points? And this was like a real low point, you know, in which we were not at all on the same page with Israel. But, you know, as far as the Ten Commandments, you know, it's interesting that, you know, what's it about, you know, Ten Commandments? What's the main thing that happened? I mean, lots of things happened, but, you know, what's the climactic thing, the climactic event in the Ten Commandments is the parting of the Red Sea. So it's all about water. It's all about who controls water and what happens when you have control over it, you know? So it's kind of really ironic and very coincidental, I guess. I guess you could say. But Cecil D. DeMille actually met with Nasser to get permission he just wanted him to, you know, to distribute the film. It was the biggest film ever made at the time, right? The biggest budget. It was blockbuster beyond any kind of blockbuster that we could imagine. The biggest cast, the most special effects, everything like that. And Nasser was really excited about it. But then reportedly when Nasser saw the movie, he was like, forget it. And he banned it from being showed in Egypt because it shows the Jews winning. I'm not sure how he was surprised by that. I always find that really funny. Like, what, he didn't know that? He hadn't read the Bible? He didn't know who wins this thing, you know? So, but whatever. That's what I read that. It's hard to believe, but whatever. All right. But, you know, certainly what we need to really put some focus on is is a film that was based on a book by Leon Uris, who was very famous as a novelist for writing about, you know, about war as a theme. But it's really with Exodus, his blockbuster novel, that becomes the blockbuster film about the U.S.-Israel relationship, right? Starring Paul Newman. And a whole sort of all-star cast, and really focusing a lot on the, not just on the refugees who are able to, you know, sort of escape from Cyprus and come to Palestine, but also on sort of what are the tactics, you know, I mean, Paul Newman's character, Ari Ben-Kanan, you know, his father, who's played by Lee J. Cobb, is, you know, sort of on one side of the equation, you know, he's much more, you know, sort of Haganah kind of, you know, like more diplomacy and stuff like that. And his uncle, who's played by David Apatashu, is, you know, like the terrorist, Irgun, whatever. And, you know, there's this famous scene in which they blow up the King David Hotel and all that kind of thing. And Paul Newman's character is sort of caught in between the middle. But what's also interesting about Paul Newman's character is he falls in love, you know, with this Christian nurse, who's played by Eva Marie Saint. And so it's very much, you could say, symbolically kind of about like an intermarriage between Judaism and Christianity, between the U.S. and Israel, you know? And, you know, this film also, I mean, in terms of just the vision of the Israeli man, you know, even though he's an American man, right? I mean, we all kind of seen him as American, even though we know he's playing in Israel. and the machismo, is that how you say it? Machismo? that he exudes, you know, is a huge part of the film. And the idea, of course, is that America is this like superpower, right? And that we're the ones in the end, you know, who, you know, need to support Israel. All right. So I want to play a song that was written by Pat Boone, but made famous by Andy Williams, which appears as, people have called this like the second Israeli national anthem. The Exodus song.
This land is mine. God gave this land to me. This brave and ancient land to me. And when the morning sun reveals her hills and plains, then I see a land where children can run free. So take my hand and walk this land with me, and walk this lovely land with me. Though I am just a man, when you are by my side, with the help of God, I know I can be. I know I can't. If I must fight, I'll fight to make this land our own. Until I die, this land is mine.
All right, so yeah, the whole idea of, you know, this land is mine, but who's speaking here? You know, I mean, it's the Israelis who are speaking. They're gonna be the ones who are fighting and they're gonna die. You know, I mean, there's the scene that you saw, you know, where they're burying the Arab friend of Paul Newman's, the Mufti, and also Salmoneo, who plays a young, you know, basically boy who joins the Irgun and gets killed, and they get buried together. You know, they're the ones who are going to be sacrificing their lives and whatever. But still, I feel like this land is mine. This is an American film. This is a Hollywood film, right? And it's like, this land is ours, you know? I mean, whether we're Jews, whether we're Christians, like, you know, the song is, you know, it's not, it's a, basically a Christian song, I guess you'd say, not really a Christian song, but it's an American popular song. And so this is, I think, in some ways, this is like, culturally, this might be like the high point of what I'm talking about today in terms of this this idea of the narcissistic extension. Although, I don't know, let's go on and let's see, maybe we'll find something that's just, you know, equally in some ways. But just to point out, I mean, there's a lot that's going on at this time period, right? So Exodus comes out 1960, you know, 61. We have the man in the glass booth, you know, the trial of Adolf Eichmann in Jerusalem, which is a worldwide, you know, people watch this all over the world. This is a huge spectacle in its own right, you know, the sort of, you know, we got him and we're gonna, like, whatever kind of vengeance we can get for the Holocaust, you know, whatever we can do, you know. At the same time, though, interestingly enough, in 1961, there's also an Israeli film, which is like the most popular Israeli film of the time. I doubt anyone's seen it or heard of it because it's very obscure to for Americans. It was released, you can find it, it's very hard to find, but it's on DVD with subtitles. It's called I Like Mike, which is clearly, you know, a play on I Like Ike. And I'll just read you a little bit. This is kind of from the promotional materials for the film. It was made at the same time as Exodus was being shot. The plot told of Yaffa and an energetic and determined matron who was busily hunting for a suitable husband who will save her daughter from the army and from an unspectacular future with Micha, her current boyfriend, who is a simple kibbutz member and military officer with no financial prospects. When Mike, a young Jewish American millionaire, arrives for a visit, Yaffa decides to pounce on this guy and marry her daughter to the wealthy American. The problem is that, you know, he's not interested in the daughter. And he actually goes to the desert. He meets this Micha, who's a military officer, and all these other Israelis on a kibbutz. And he's like, forget it. I'm never going back to America. I'm not marrying your daughter. And I'm just going to hang out on the kibbutz. So basically, it's like the anti-Exodus. It's like, no, forget about those American values. And Americans want to, like, determine, you know, they want to rule everything. And they want to decide, you know, like, they want to be in control of everything. We've got our own culture. We're very proud of it. It has a lot of actually anti-materialistic or, you know, sort of non-materialistic values to it on the, that are exemplified by the kibbutz. And we're fine. Thank you very much. So, you know, it's sort of interesting to counterpose these two things. It became a really popular stage musical, as you can see, in Israel as well. And, you know, it's just worth asking, like, why was this so popular at exactly the time? By the way, Exodus, I mean, there was a lot of money that was spent in terms of the filming of Exodus, but there was a lot of resentment that was bred as well, you know, in terms of, like, that it was seen as a film that really, really distorted the history of the founding of Israel and the sacrifices that Israelis made. And so, like, it just, they just saw it as kind of getting it all wrong. All right. Other thing that I want to talk about, which you may or may not have heard about, is a wonderful Broadway musical called Milk and Honey by Jerry Herman. Jerry Herman, before he became like Jerry Herman in a way, wrote this musical about a group of widows who travels to Israel. And one of the widows is sort of befriended by an American man who's visiting his married daughter. He's Baltimore, he's played by Robert Weedy, the tenor in the original production. And And but the cast of widows, the group of widows, is led, as you can see all the way on the left, by none other than Molly Picon. And there's actually a wonderful song. I'm not going to play it right now, but look up Milk and Honey from 1961. And there's a wonderful song in which she sings about being single and how she's tired of being single and how it's not so great being single and being a widow. And she needs to like get married again and sort of have a life. But I thought instead of that one, and here's a scene from the production, I would play Eddie Fisher singing a song from the.
This is the land of milk and honey. This is the land of sun and song. And this is a world of
that. And the other thing that I want to highlight is, I think, a really interesting documentary that was made of a trip to Israel by Frank Sinatra, who, you know, was very active in terms of children's issues, who was also very, very connected to Jews and felt very, I think it was a Shabbos goy when he was a kid. And, you know, he had a real affection for Jews, and he felt like he was almost like an honorary Jew in some ways. He was also in the movie Cast a Giant Shadow, you know, so that was interesting too. He was in maybe a couple of films in which he played Jewish characters. All right, so I'm going to play, this is 22 minutes. I'm just going to play the last like 2 or 3 minutes of it. So I'm going to skip through all the places that he goes and all the things that he does. I'm going to go to about 19. Here we go.
No love at all without a
hits you the minute you see its uniformed men and women. Hard as steel in combat, these fellows are gentle when in civilian togs. Only yesterday they were on the run fleeing Nazis and other enemies, and now they stand firmly rooted in a soil they revived through their sweat and blood.
From that, but I do want to say, look, Frank Sinatra is probably the most popular, you know, most successful singer, you know, in the country at that time. And this was not a film that was made for Jews, right? I mean, in particular, But you can imagine the effect that this probably had on, you know, both Jews and non-Jews, you know, in terms of, you know, like these images of Israel as this like proud, you know, they've accomplished so much, they've fled from persecution, and now they've come and they've built up this army and they're, you know, like real vigor and vim and vitality and all those kinds of things. I wish I had time to talk about, I don't really have time to talk about Israeli food and sort of the popularization of Israeli food in America. It's not really until the 1980s that any Americans have really heard of hummus or falafel or anything like that. That's certainly part of popular culture. It's not really visual culture, maybe. Well, maybe it is, actually. Maybe it does fit. But I want to move pretty quickly. So 1960s, also we have the building of, there's a lot of tourism starting to, and Israel is, I mean, people have talked about it as like kind of like a development project of the United States. There's a lot of money that's being poured in to help Israel to really develop into a modern country. And I'll just read, this is from Israel and the American Mind by Shalom Middleton. The Hilton Tel Aviv's opening night involved a special spectacle. A white finished pony flown to Tel Aviv especially for the event was strutted into the ballroom carrying a cart of frozen oranges filled with ice cream. As the pony entered, the waiters broke with the singing of Heveinu Shalom Aleichem, a popular and loud Hebrew tune. The pony, a report for the Daily Ma'ariv, explained, was taken aback by the commotion and proceeded to empty his bowels shamelessly on the Hilton carpet in front of the hundreds of people in attendance. So this is September 1965, and this is like the symbol of like, you know, modern, you know, Tel Aviv as like a modern city among the cities of the world. So 1960s leading up to, you know, the Six Day War, there's a lot going on in terms of economic investment. A lot of donations that are flowing in from American Jews. In this film, Salah Shabati, starring Topol, which I'm sure many of you have seen, it's sort of a staple of Hebrew language classes. You know, there's a very funny, famous scene in which they show a group of visiting American tourists the forest that's been named in their honor, you know, they've donated to have the trees planted. And then as soon as they leave, you know, they take down the sign and they show the same forest to another group of people from another city in the United States. So it's sort of, you know, it's a satire on, you know, those foolish Americans who think that they're, you know, doing more than they're actually doing. So I want to get to, these are rallies in the late 60s, but, you know, really the, this is a British magazine cover, but it's very, very important to think for a minute about what the Six-Day War really means for American Jews. There's been a lot written about the fact that there's a surge in pride in being Jewish that happens in the wake of the 1967 war. But I don't think it's necessarily been analyzed to the point that it could be. I've been reading a lot about this. And I think that, you know, what's very interesting is the timing, right? If you think about it, so Israel wins this incredible, miraculous, unbelievable victory, you know, in 6 days against all the Arab countries that are arrayed against them. And, you know, so this is 1967. So how are Americans looking at this? You know, we at the time are stuck in this quagmire in Vietnam, right? Which we cannot get out of. We can't get out of it in 6 years, much less 6 days, right? And there's this huge, you know, as you know, there's this huge sort of, you know, frustration and anger and you know, all kinds of turmoil as a result of that, you know, the whole anti-war movement and everything. And Israel is kind of like the total opposite of this, you know? They are able to achieve this astonishing victory. And the Israelis are seen, you know, as, you know, really kind of like exactly the role models, you know, that we should be, you know, that we should be emulating. And, you know, there's something, again, like to talk about masculinity, there's something incredibly masculine about these citizen soldiers who are just ordinary people, basically, you know, who just kind of go off to war, you know, and they're able to, you know, to defeat their, you know, their enemies. So I think there's a lot there. And I think that there's, you know, I mean, it's interesting to think about in terms of this concept, again, of the narcissistic extension, you know, I mean, in a case like that, like what could be more of a shepping of nachas when you think about what we had done, particularly as American Jews, to build up that country, to give money, to travel there, to buy products from there, right? I mean, there had been this connection that had been established, especially on the part of American Jews. It wasn't until 1960, actually, that John F. Kennedy uses the words a special relationship to refer to the U.S.-Israel political political alliance, which is maybe later than many of us would think. You know, it's also interesting because it's in the news right now, this whole controversy over whether Sirhan Sirhan should be released from jail after all these decades for assassinating Robert F. Kennedy right after he gets nominated by the California Democratic Party, you know, for president. Sirhan Sirhan was, you know, I mean, he said that the reason he assassinated Robert F. Kennedy was because of his support for Israel. So it's interesting to sort of trace the parallels between like what the U.S. governmental, and this is what obviously I got more interested when I was at AIPAC, you know, the governmental connections and the, you know, connections that American Jews had and non-Jews as well, by seeing the Israeli victory, by seeing Sinatra go to Israel, by seeing Leonard Bernstein again conducting on Mount Scopus. And this is Bernstein. I'm going to skip this in the interest of time, but it's actually really interesting if you look it up. Journey to Jerusalem with Bernstein and Isaac Stern. This is Bernstein. But as far as, you know, the 67 war, I mean, this is Yossi Israeli, supposedly that's his real name, you know, who was profiled by Life magazine. And, you know, the guy who's like, he's hanging out in Tel Aviv, you know, with his girlfriends, and he's going out to the cafes and to the nightclubs and whatever, you know, he's like this young, you know, virile, you know, attractive guy. And he's like the symbol of modern Israel because he puts on an army uniform and they're able to do all these incredible things. Now, this doesn't last very long, unfortunately, as many of you know. The 1973 Yom Kippur War is nothing like the 67 War. It's a little bit of a disaster. Golda Meir is forced from power, and there's really much less of a sense that the Israelis are as, you know, invulnerable and indomitable as they seem during the 67 War. And so they need more help, you know, like we need to help them more. And eventually, of course, we have Camp David in 1976, which is really my first memory. I mean, I was born in 68, so I was 8 years old, 1978. So I was 10 years old, sorry, it was 1978, when Camp David happened. And, you know, that was my first memory really of having any consciousness of Israel and of, you know, the connections among, you know, America and Israel and Egypt and so on. But I don't want to just talk about men. I mean, I think it's interesting too to talk about women and the way that Hadassah magazine, for example, in late 1960s and into the early 1970s was really promoting a new image of the Israeli woman, you know, both the Israeli woman in the army and the Israeli woman who was fashionable and who was, you know, really coming into her own in terms of the feminist movement, which is happening in Israel in the same way it was happening in the United States. So I don't think you would have seen Golda Meir washing dishes anymore by the 1970s. all right, so I want to move quickly. I love collecting all these images of posters, travel posters. This is my favorite, actually. I love this one. Isn't it great? It's so interesting, like this combining of the past and the future. I just think it's a brilliant idea. I'm really into posters. Of course, also 1970s, you have Israeli authors who are starting to become popular in translation in America, and people are starting to read Amichai and really falling in love with his poetry. A.B. Yehoshua, his novels, Amos Oz, and his novels. So that's a whole other aspect of culture that we could get into, but I'm going to skip over that. This is a Night of Stars, Star Salute Israel at 30, and Golda Meir actually appears in this. I'm going to skip through it, but Barbra Streisand, clearly, I mean, somebody who like really was a big Israel supporter, traveled back and forth to Israel, so on and so forth. You can't really not mention Streisand in this context. If you're going to talk about Sinatra, you have to talk about Streisand. And then eventually you probably have to talk about Madonna. But talk about films, I want to just briefly say, I mean, obviously the other thing that was, I think, really showed the vulnerability of Israel was the Munich massacre at the Olympics in 1972, which, you know, this year's Summer Olympics was the first time that there was actually a moment of silence for the Israeli athletes who were murdered in Munich. And took a long time for the widows of those athletes to be able to get the Olympic Commission to agree to have them included in the moment of silence at the beginning of the Olympics, which is a shame, but at least it happened. It finally happened, you know, this summer. I mean, obviously Spielberg's very famous movie about Munich, but to go back a little bit, Black Sunday, if you haven't seen it, is kind of a really interesting film, and it makes the Vietnam connection very explicit because it's about a Vietnam veteran who was brainwashed by the Vietnamese into being opposed, you know, against his own country and attacking his own country. And he teams up with this female terrorist, and they come up with this plot to attack the Super Bowl. it's a really kind of an interesting movie. I don't want to spoil it for you, but you know, they're going to wait until the Super Bowl is completely filled with fans, and then they're going to they're going to try to kill as many people as they can from the blimp by exploding the Goodyear blimp. Interesting concept. Of course, Entebbe, you could say, like, that's an example of the Israelis really reasserting themselves. I mean, that's a pretty incredible victory that they have. You know, to be able to defeat these terrorists who had hijacked the airplane and the whole Ugandan army at the same time, you know, led by this dictator, Idi Amin. So this is just one film that was made about, the raid on Entebbe. That's 1977. And then I'm going to skip forward to 1986. If you've ever seen Delta Force, with Chuck Norris and Lee Marvin, this was made by Golan Globus. I don't know if you remember, but, Golan Globus was this fascinating. It was like the first kind of really successful Israeli film studio that became an American film studio because they bought a studio in Hollywood, and they made the worst movies, the schlockiest, most, you know, B, what do they call that? B movies, you know, that they were turning them out like one a week. I mean, they had a whole different way of making movies rather than like making movies over a period of months and years and whatever, you know, they were like, we're just going to make them as quick as we can, churn them out as quickly as we can. And they made some horrible movies, but they also made some kind of interesting ones. I don't think Delta Force is a great movie, but it's a good example, at least, you know, of certainly with, you know, with the idea of killing terrorists who hijacked an airplane. Camp David, 1978. Madonna, I mentioned. We could talk a lot about Madonna and her turn towards Judaism and her concerts in Israel. Israeli fashion. There's a lot to talk about, but we're running out of time. So I just want to make sure that we get to, because I know people are going to have questions about this or want to talk about some of the TV shows that have recently come out as Israel really has developed a mature film and television industry. I mean, Israeli movies used to be terrible. And now Israel is at the forefront, you know? And of course, these TV shows are all and movies are all, you know, produced internationally, you know, with American investment and other countries' investment. So you can see them as Israeli. You can also see them as sort of multinational in terms of their sort of provenance. But Chatufim, Prisoners of War, is actually my favorite in some ways. If you've never seen it, I really recommend it. It's very, very amazing depth of characterization. And it's about, you know, it's a basis for Homeland. It's about three captured Israelis who are finally released and the lives that they try to resume when they come back to Israel. Wonderful show. Homeland, I just include because there was a season that was filmed in Lebanon, but it was set in Lebanon, but it was filmed in Israel. And so there was this wonderful feature in the New York Times Magazine of Claire Danes spending time exploring Tel Aviv. And then, you know, I mean, there's so many shows now, Srugim, I'm going too fast. Forgetting the name. Remind me. Shtissel, right, thank you. I just blanked on Shtissel. The Spy with Sacha Baron Cohen. And I want to get to Fauda. Okay. And then we can have a discussion.
Welcome to Fauda, a Netflix sensation where nothing is ever as it seems. Fauda means chaos in Arabic, but on TV, it spells high-octane thriller. The series follows an undercover Israeli counterterrorism unit working in the West Bank. Season 2 drops May 24th, and already Fauda is being hailed as groundbreaking. The reason? It does something journalists have at times failed to do. It tells two sides of the same story.
The unique point of view of Fauda was that it actually showed also the Palestinian narrative, not only the Israeli one.
The show was created by two guys who know their stuff. Leo Raz, a former undercover operative in the Israeli military, and Avi Sascharov, an Israeli journalist covering Palestinian affairs. 2 years ago, Netflix acquired their show, and ever since, there's been a groundswell of followers all over the world.
It was very, very interesting how everybody embraced it. You could see huge articles in the New Yorker about it, and in the New York Times chose it for one of the best TV series in the world.
Raz based the show on his own life in the elite Dudevan unit of the Israeli army. But he also plays the lead character, a former undercover officer named Doron Kabilio, who comes out of retirement for one last mission, to track and kill a notorious Hamas terrorist called the Panther. As if you needed another reason to binge watch anything, consider this. Fauda is somehow beloved by both Israelis and Palestinians.
Avi Sascharov is one of the writers of Fauda, and he said that so many people from Gaza and from the West Bank used to call him and told him that they were watching the show and that they were moved by it.
Reaction from the Arab world caught the producers by surprise, but perhaps they should have seen it coming. From the beginning, the creators of Fauda paid attention to realistic details and vowed to tell their story in a way that no one has ever done before.
The name of the show is in Arabic.
The ads
were in Arabic. Most dialogues are in Arabic on Israeli Prime TV.
You don't hear Arabic in Israel anymore.
One of the show's most heart-wrenching scenes is about a new bride whose husband was killed by undercover soldiers on their wedding day. She volunteers to be a martyr, but scared out of her wits, she heads to a Tel Aviv bar and orders a drink. Sensing she's upset, the bartender asks her if she's okay. That quick interaction changes everything. The widow, who'd been ordered to leave the bomb in the club and exit to a waiting car, makes another move instead. She decides to die alongside everyone around her and blows herself up.
It was like, what's going on here? This is kind of interesting. They're not all wonderful. They're not all evil.
Massiem is a Palestinian actor in Los Angeles. He said he was surprised that he sympathized with the lead Israeli character, an operative who discovers his wife has been cheating.
I felt a little bad for him. I felt bad for the Israeli characters.
It is very important for people to understand what's going on in the other side. And I think that that was a success.
Perhaps a very big success, despite a very small screen. Itai Had, The Rap, Hollywood.
All right. Okay. All right. So that's exactly, it's exactly 5 o'clock, correct? Your time? So that was exactly an hour. So can we have some little bit of time for questions?
Yeah, I think there are a lot of questions. We spent a lot of time with history. We only got to the contemporary stuff at the end. Wish we had spent a little more time on it, but I think you were building up the history. If correct me if I'm wrong, I think the point you're trying to make, or maybe a point that I took away, is that the early history of Israel is portrayed in American film and culture. It was made by Americans. And now, and this is, we just didn't spend enough time on it. Now, what we're seeing is Israeli films and Israeli life being made by Israelis. And that's a big difference. I don't think we're seeing as much it made in America for a variety of reasons. I don't think it's anti-Israel, anti-Semitism. I just don't think that that's necessarily the issue of the day, but the Israelis are making it, and they're making it much better. And that's this, and that's why Fauda is so successful. Is that correct?
I think you could say that. I mean, I think there are still questions. I mean, obviously that trailer, which is a little bit out of date because it was before the release of the second season, already there have been three seasons of Fauda. But I think, you know, I mean, I've read quite a lot of articles about Fauda that have suggested that even though the Israelis might like to think that they're making this TV show that's so even-handed, you know, that they're not necessarily representing the Palestinians in the way that they, you know, as realistically as you would think. I mean, for example, like they never use the word "quote unquote" occupation in the show. There must be a reason for that, and they also make it seem as if ISIS is operating in the West Bank, which I've never heard of ISIS operating in the West Bank. But what's really interesting for me about Fauda is that the whole point is that this is an Israeli, you know, group of counter-terrorists who pretend to be Arabs in order to foil these terrorist plots, you know? And so the distinction between who is Jewish and who is Arab is constantly being blurred. I mean, Lior Raz's character, right? He's an Arab Jew. So he speaks Arabic. His character speaks Arabic, you know, natively. And these characters all switch back and forth between speaking in Arabic and speaking in Hebrew. But the Jews pretend to be Arabs and the Arabs pretend to be Jews. I mean, it's like, and so I think what it makes you wonder is like, how much of a difference really is there? And I think that's the biggest contribution of the show.
Right, but my point is, based on the history you gave us, is that the Israelis are now commanding the story.
Yes. Right.
Now, they may not be telling it perfectly,
right,
but they're telling a story, and the story is much more resonant and it's much more contemporary. And 100%. So when Francine and Ron Morrison want to watch a show, they're going to open up Netflix, and there's so many films. You only mentioned some, but there's tons of films, and they're very good, and they're Israeli made. And so we're not, it's no longer America making these films that are really certainly unrealistic. We'll use that word. The films and everything you showed us at the beginning was important in the evolution of American-Israeli relation and had a role to play in helping Israel. But it was very much propaganda. Now you have Israelis making films themselves, and they're willing to even put dark things out there. And I think that people appreciate it.
Let me just say very quickly, Ari, there's a lot at stake right now because there's so much anti-Semitism and so much anti-Zionism, right, that's happening right now in this country. And so it's a good question. Like, how does this read, you know? I mean, particularly in the non-Jewish, you know, America, is there any way that this could help to, you know, sort of push back against some of those prejudices?
Well, let me ask, since you finished your role working for AIPAC, you work for Jewish Federation now. Yeah. Both of them are obviously very involved, AIPAC specifically, but Jewish Federation involved in issues of Israel. So how are those two organizations reading these films coming and these shows coming out of Israel? Are they seeing it as good things? Are they seeing it as bad? Are they seeing it as helpful? Are they seeing it as unhelpful?
I mean, I don't think there's much talk about it, to be honest. I mean, I know that the last AIPAC conference, they actually started out the conference with there were a couple of people from FAD, I can't remember exactly who they were, who were like on the main stage and whatever, who like started out on, like Saturday night, like right after Abdullah. So they were making a big deal about it. It was like before the third, it was like a preview of the premiere of the third season. But you know, and I think generally, you know, like there's a very, very positive view of these kinds of shows. But as far as Jewish federations, I mean, I don't think there's much. I mean, that's kind of like what I wanted to do in the first place, was I felt like there wasn't enough discussion of the effect that these shows were having on the
I think it's crazy. If you're telling me that the federations are not using these films as discussion and springboards and exploring contemporary Israel and nations.
It's possible that individual federations are. I don't know. I mean, I work for the umbrella organization, so right. I'm sort of less in touch with programs that individual federations are doing. But you know what? It's a good point. I'm gonna look into that.
Well, we hosted one of the writers of Valley of Tears. If you haven't seen that program that we hosted with CSP, it was spectacular. We're gonna have him back. Because he's a writer who also wrote the story about Gilad, the murderer of Yitzhak Rabin, and he wrote I forget the name of the show in Israel, but he wrote it, and it's kind of talking about how this could happen. And we're going to have other Israeli writers in the next 12 months who are writing these things that you're all seeing. And if this is discussion only CSP is having, great for CSP, but that would be ludicrous. One of the big problems we have is the younger generation not connected to Israel, and not connected to Israel because the Israel that they know of is Israel that you showed us in the first 45 minutes of the presentation, which is an unreal Israel. And so to them, when they see the news and they see what's going on, it doesn't resonate. In fact, it turns them off. The stuff that you're showing us in the last few minutes is much more resonant and relevant and something that should be out there and should be shown on campuses and should be shared and discussed. It's a more nuanced Israel, and it's not a rah-rah Israel. It's just a more realistic, and what I like is that it's coming from Israel. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not, obviously not coming from America. America may be bankrolling it in a certain way. Maybe that's the difference. America was making those films that you showed us. Mm-hmm. America now is bankrolling these films in a way, and they're bringing them to us through Netflix and Amazon and Hulu. Yes. And we're watching them. So I think it's, I think that's the pivot. That's the change. Again, I go back to federations and to AIPAC. I'm sure they're doing it. I know that Stiesel had a whole dog and pony show where they brought the actors to the United States and they were in LA and they were in New York.
Yeah, I remember that.
And I also know that these shows are resonant amongst non-Jews.
The cast of Stiesel, they're like appeared everywhere. I mean,
right. So I think that's the change. I mean, it was nice. A lot of the stuff you showed, I've never seen. You know, Francine was singing one of the songs. I didn't know about the Broadway show. I haven't seen any of those material. So it's great. Like, it would make a great book, you know, history of the evolution. But I think we have to spend more time, and we will, CSP, we will spend more time on what is going on now and these Israeli writers who are willing to go there, whether it's Valley of Tears and the Yom Kippur War, or contemporary, you know, issues with terrorism. I think that everyone online right now, everybody on CSP audience, certainly willing to go there. And I think younger people would go there more willingly if they saw that. It would pull them in, and it would give them things to talk about that relate to what's going
100%.
On. I'm seeing if there's any other questions from people. I will share with all of you some of the stuff that was referred. You know, you can see I'm sure I can find the documentaries and you can watch them. Gatekeepers, there's a show called Rita Rubens has a show called Gatekeepers. I don't know that one. Do you know that one, Ted?
No.
So I have a list of all contemporary shows. I'll share you. When, you know, Ron and Francine were supposed to go to Israel with us, and I gave them a 100-page reading list. It wasn't really a reading list. It was a 100-page resource packet, which had things they had to read and things they had to watch, and it included movies, television, and so on, and I updated it. So I'll share that with all of you as well, because I know that Ron and Francine have watched them all. If you have questions on any of the shows, I'll give you Ron and Francine's phone number and you can call them and probably talk to them about it as well. But Hit and Run, that's a new show. Debbie Podless mentions, I know that's very new because someone had referenced that as well. William says, for some of them, the old films were real and still important. Yeah, I think that's why Ted spent all the time on it. They were real. Many of you grew up watching films or reading Exodus, but you should know that Leon Uris's view of history is not historic. It's very much historical fiction. And it was meant to be more of an emotional tug than historical reality. And that's why I think Ted mentioned there was trouble with even the film of it, because people were addressing the historical inaccuracies in it. It doesn't make it less important, because it's important because you watched it and you have the emotions in it. But if you really want to understand history and how Israel is portrayed, I guess the good thing of what one thing we learned from this program is how it's changed, you know, from Exodus to Fauda. There's a big change. Gatekeeper 2012 is a documentary with all living heads of Shin Bet. So that's a documentary as opposed to a show, Rita Rubin. And it shows you again that Israel is willing to make shows that are focused on contemporary issues and maybe a little more self-critical than the American shows that we just saw, not willing to go there. And, you know, I would say in the 50s and 60s, we didn't need that. We didn't need to be critical about Israel. But now I think we need to be more real as to what we see. And again, I said, my point is, I'm happy to see that Israel is making these shows. Okay. Any other questions? Hayudim Baim. Yeah. So Ted, have you watched Hayudim Baim, which is a social satire series?
I've heard of it, but I haven't seen it yet.
So we did a CSP program last year with the creators of Ayyudin Bayim. I'd like to bring him back. That is a very funny social satire. It is so satiric that they get that they will pick on anybody, but they picked on Haredim as well. And so there's been protests. They're on public television. So there's been protests outside of the Israeli government to stop funding them. But what I like about them is they're willing to be self-critical. And they do it in a satiric, funny way, but it does hit. I mean, they give you some gut punches. What's amazing is they don't make it for us in America. That is made for Israeli audiences, and it's in Hebrew, but some of the episodes now are in English, and you can see that. So thank you, Shirley Cohen, for mentioning that. I know you guys all have your favorite stuff. So what I'll do is I'll email to Ted kind of my list of what I know of contemporary Israeli shows and how to find them. And maybe Ted, you can add on to them or suggest things. But sure. I think it's very important. And if you're working in the world of federations on the highest level, then what you talked about today is very important to flesh out and show and share, I guess, nationally through federation.
Great.
Any other questions before we, Bonnie mentions Tehran, which is another thrilling, thriller of a show on Apple TV. If you haven't seen that, Ron and Francine, tonight before the holidays start, you've seen it. You have. Okay. You've seen everything. I don't know if that was even on my list, but I'm glad. If anybody else had any other shows, you can email me and I'll make sure that they're on the list. Tehran is one of the more recent ones. I think with that, I wanted to thank Ted for addressing the topic and being with us today and taking us through the history of how Israel has been portrayed in American films till today. And I appreciate you all being with us. And The Band's Visit, thank you, Tom Barth. That's a movie.
Oh, I love The Band's Visit, yeah.
Great movie, a little slow, but beautiful. It's not quite Fauda. I personally, just so you know, my personal thing is I cannot watch Fauda because it's too real. It's too, but I can watch many other films and maybe I'll try to get back into Fauda. So thank you all for being with us today. I have to go get back in the sukkah for some final additions. I wish you all a happy, healthy holiday coming up. Looking forward to seeing you in the next few weeks. If you're new to CSP, go to occsp.net. You'll find out what we've got coming up. And yes, we will be hosting many of the writers of these programs in Israel. So you can ask them questions about their writing and about what they're thinking and some of the issues that have come up. You know, what's interesting to me is how their work has been perceived in Israel and who is supporting it, who is not supporting it. And as Ted mentioned, is it resonating outside of Israel, particularly in the Arab world? I think that's very interesting to me. So thank you all. Thank you, Ted.
Thanks again.
Thanks, everybody. Take care. Bye.